Hey, I'm Charyn Harris, and welcome to my channel. I'm a musician, a professor of music industry studies, and the host of the Charyn Harris Experience on SiriusXM Studio 54 Radio. I am obsessed with the backstories of people who move the needle in music, lifestyle, and culture. Tune in, and I guarantee you're going to be obsessed too. Let's get into it. Oh, and before we do, make sure you're following me on socials and subscribing to my channel. You're about to listen to my interview with PR legend Chris Chambers of the Chambers Group. You can hear this interview in its entirety on the Charyn Harris Experience, exclusively on SiriusXM's Studio 54 Radio. So, illusion, smoke and mirrors, not really, but we do have some magic makers when it comes to getting profiles out and making sure that you know different artists and what they specialize in and everything that's so wonderful about them. So today we have a magic maker wizard in the house, Chris Chambers. Chris Chambers, how are you?
Great. How are you?
I am awesome. I am so excited to have you here. You know, with Studio 54 Radio, a lot of it leans towards disco. But because I, as you did, grew up in a really interesting era where there were these intersections of disco and new jack swing and house music and,
exactly,
you know, and everything else, and going to the Limelight and Shelter and Paradise, yeah, Garage and
exactly, and the World and Mars and Nels and all those like iconic New York spots that made New York nightlife so amazing. I definitely lived and was fortunate enough to be part of that great nightlife in New York. I always tell people I was fortunate to catch the tail end of it, because, you know, of course I wasn't around for Studio 54, and I wasn't also old enough for Paradise Garage. Like, when I started to go out, Paradise Garage was just ending, and all my older friends, because I always had older friends, like when I was in high school, I had friends that were in college, so it was always like that. But my older friends, they experienced the Garage, and then I caught the remnants of it, which after the Garage closed, there was another club that all the Garage heads went to, and it just slipped out of my head, but I'll remember it. But anyway, that's where it started for me.
Right. Well, there was Area, there was Shelter, there was the Tunnel.
Yeah, there was, well, it was, okay, Area definitely, yeah. The Shelter definitely, yeah. It was,
and we would go to Nell's, and so, yes. So to let you know, I used to lie about my age and get into the Garage.
Well, see, and I lied about my age to get into like Shelter and Nell's, all of it, yeah,
all those places. And I have an older brother, so he would they would like look at me and go, wait, and he would go, she's with me, and they'd go, okay. And he was a big dude, so they weren't going to mess with him. So I'm really grateful, because I got to see the night that Grace Jones had the body paint with Keith Haring.
Whoa.
Yeah, there were just so many amazing, yeah.
Exactly, an iconic moment in New York nightlife, yeah.
Yeah. Well, that nightlife, how did it help influence you to do what you do? Because you're like the guru in this space.
Well, you know what? It's funny, because I don't think it was so much the nightlife. I mean, I'll tell you the quick side of my professional career. You know, I'm born and raised in New York, definitely a New York kid. Went to NYU as a journalism major. Of course, being at NYU and in the midst of the village, as we used to call it back then, and not, I mean, yes, it was Soho, but back then everyone called it the village. And, right, you know, all the Nike, as you know, the meatpacking area was all grunge. It was dirty and everything, but all the clubs were there and in LES, the Lower East Side in New York. And, you know, that just going to school, you know, in the heart of downtown Manhattan, you know, Soho, that really opened up my eyes to nightlife. But PR really happened through the program at NYU, the journalism program, where we had a PR workshop as part of the curriculum. And I just kind of, it was fascinating. And then when it was time for me to do a internship, they found me a great internship with this company, small boutique firm called Set to Run Public Relations. And Set to Run was this boutique firm that literally worked with all the major labels, Def Jam, Columbia, you know, or Epic, all of those. And the founder, Layla Turkan, was very close to Russell Simmons. And the company was basically it acted as the in-house PR department for Def Jam at the time, when Russell was still running the company and Lior Cohen. So that was like my entry into PR.
The importance of what you do in creating these images, or just kind of getting the images out there. So how, it's so fascinating. It's like so incredibly fascinating to take these images. And so when you're in there and you're seeing the process, what was that like?
Well, at the time that I entered the business, it was the most creative time within entertainment, whether it was music, film, TV, whatever. And, you know, at the end of the day, it was about just going full throttle and creating strong images, creating unique, you know. I think during that era, you just strive for excellence. You know, that was the thing. There was no good. It just had to be excellent. It had to be the best. And there was no Instagram and there was no TikTok, and you had to use your imagination and you had to create stories and with great images. And, you know, and it's just a different time right now in terms of, you know, I think, you know, that level of using your mind, your, you know, that inner thing to really drive the creative, you know, the storytelling that comes from your imagination.
Right. You know?
And so that's really what it was. It was like your imagination. You would hear a song, or you would see, you know, inspiration on the street, or you know, just you were inspired, and that's where the ideas came from. You know.
Interesting. So I think one of the first artists that I recall in terms of PR. Well, there were a couple that were, I think, more tied with disco, because it may have been, you know, budgets, image. That's what was happening. You know, Donna Summer, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I remember there was press. There was actually press about her, which I really wasn't seeing, you know, that much. Or maybe I wasn't paying attention because I was so young, you know, and I may not have been paying attention. But, you know, looking at, and there were tons of artists and dance music. But yet only a certain few really understood or really got there. You know, of course, Minnie Riperton, but it was...
Exactly. I mean, for me, I can tell you a very early situation in my career that kind of speaks on what you're talking about, because when I got to PolyGram Records, early on as a PR manager, they had an artist, and I'm going to say her name because everyone knows her. She's had, you know, a few dance hits, Crystal Waters. Mm-hmm. And at the time, you know, I mean, that sound and all was strictly for the clubs. And Crystal came on the scene with, you know, her, that massive hit, La-Di-Di, La-Di-Da.
Oh, Gypsy Woman.
Yeah, Gypsy Woman. And it was interesting to, even from the PR side, to work with an artist like that coming out of the club scene and gaining this general market appeal. And, you know, it was an exciting time. I mean, she was, you know, here it is, a dance artist that was popular in the clubs for years, making, you know, such almost like as if she just arrived on the scene, even though she had been recording and had club hits before that. And, you know, taking her to the mainstream, doing TV and national magazines and you know, people actually knowing her, you know, knowing her name and face, it was quite a journey, especially at that time in my career, because I was literally just, you know, a baby PR executive.
Wow. So you were able to basically take Crystal and, you know, and her, with her career and what she was doing and her image, and spread it in a different way, because artists were usually kept in a box.
Yep.
No, especially black artists. Were
Definitely. No, exactly.
And kept in a box.
Yeah, no, and what helped her is that the record was so massive. Gypsy Woman became such a massive mainstream record that they couldn't deny her that access to late night TV shows like The Tonight Show and Letterman and things like that. And, you know, the New York Times being interested in speaking to her, and, you know, just outlets that were definitely, you know, mainstream, you know, because as I said, she came from the club world, you know, she was known in the clubs, but
yes.
And, you know, and as we all know from that era, that was a community within itself, you know.
Absolutely. So, you know, absolutely. Because that's like Nels, that's, you know, Barbara Tucker was there.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yes.
Yep. Cece Peniston, all those.
Right.
Yeah.
And So it was, and it was limited, and everybody didn't break through. And of course, Madonna, you know, who was kind of, I would say, adjacent.
Yes.
Madonna was adjacent.
Yeah. She started in the clubs in New York, but didn't build a massive platform there before she broke into the mainstream. I mean, she started there, but it moved quickly for her. Yeah.
Yeah.